lovely room?
Oh, I remember it perfectly. Mary, don't you remember Lulu playing on the piano near the window? I can see that piano still.
Yes. Oh, Sally, doesn't it seem years since we came here? Who'd have thought that one day I'd be living in this house?
It looks larger than ever, now that poor old Dr. Andrews' furniture is gone.
If only we'd been certain we were coming, I'd have bought some things at the auction.
Mummy, I'm sure the sitting room carpet will never fit in here.
No, I'm dreadfully worried about carpets. They'll all be too small, and we can't possibly afford any new ones.
Mrs. Andrews always sat in this corner, remember? Old Mrs. Andrews that was, Lulu's grandmother. She was about 100, and she wore a little lace cap. Oh, Mary, do you remember how we used to be led up to her, and then she had to shout at her down her ear trumpet?
Curtains.
And
now,
then,
where's my little book? I must see about the measurements. Width. Yes. No, that's the length. Yes. Just hold the tape measure this end, Gwen.
And when she stopped talking to you, she used to take the air trumpet away. So you never got any conversation at all. Not that she could hear.
There. Oh, thank heavens, that ought to be just about right. Now, I'm going to start doing some working out.
I suppose this alcove was where Mother used to flirt with her one-armed colonel.
Just fancy him turning up again.
Oh, do be quiet, you two. I want to make some calculations. I wish you'd go somewhere else for a few minutes.
Come upstairs and see my room again, Aunt Sally. Or should I say my rooms? I just can't believe it. My own bedroom and my own little study right off.
I love this window seat, darling. You'll be able to sit here in the summer and smell the roses outside the window and dream about your love affairs.
It'll be so lovely to have my own sitting room. Or study. No, I think I shall call it my boudoir. I wonder if I shall ever have enough money to have it furnished just as I'd really like it.
You start saving up.
White walls and white paint. And the furniture all covered in saffron yellow with little buttons on it. Or shall I have the walls cream and have modern furniture covered with red leather?
You couldn't have that in here, Gwen.
No, I suppose not. I wouldn't want to anyway. I don't like that kind. It'll be years before I could afford the other kind. But I might start saving up for some pretty chintz or cretonne. I wonder how long I shall be at Peter Craddock's.
Darling, what on earth does Bob say to your working in the garage place as a secretary?
Well, as a matter of fact, he doesn't know yet. You see, as I took the job while he was away, I thought it was better not to write and tell him. It's so much easier to explain when he comes back.
Is he coming back today?
Well, no. That's what makes it rather awkward. I thought he would. But he wrote and said he'd go straight to work tomorrow. So I suppose he'll just find me there.
I don't suppose he'll mind, really.
Well, I don't know. It's rather funny sometimes. I've got a feeling he may be a bit cross. But Peter Craddock offered me the job, and you can't blame me for taking it. I do hope Bob doesn't go up in smoke.
Well, I may as well say that the dining room won't have any carpets or any curtains.
But, darling, the dining room carpet will fit in there.
Yes, but the awkward thing is, now we've got a real surgery with its own waiting room, we need an extra carpet for the waiting room, which was the dining room carpet.
But why must we give up the dining room carpet?
Daddy says the patients are more important than our meals. I don't know what to do. We can't afford even a second-hand one. Oh, dear. My head's in such a whirl. What with the carpets and the curtains and making all the arrangements for moving. How I'm going to get done in the next few weeks, I just don't know.
This morning, Gwen went off to work again to her new job at Peter Craddock's. And I wondered how Bob would behave when she turned up and found her there. Jim came and told us he'd met Dick Mutty coming out of the underground.
Hi, Dick. Dick Mutty. Dick.
Dr. Dale.
I didn't see you, sir.
What are you doing? Just got back? You don't seem to have any luggage with you.
No, you see, Bob had to go straight to work, and I decided to rush back here and have a bath and shave before I went off to the War Office. So we've left all the stuff at Paddington, and we're meeting there to pick it up tonight.
Oh, I see. So you had a good time on your boat?
Marvellous. Absolutely marvellous. How's Gwen?
Gwenny? Oh, she's fine.
I suppose you've heard nothing about the move?
We have heard, indeed. I thought Mary had written to Bob, but perhaps she thought he wouldn't get the letter in time. Yes, we're off, Dick. Moving a fortnight next Saturday.
Oh, I see.
We shall miss you, Dick. You must come and see us often.
Yes, I will, of course. But it won't be the same as having you living next door and seeing Gwen going off to work and coming home from work and, having you all next door.
Talking of Gwen going to work, Bob's going to get a surprise.
What's that, sir?
Well, Gwen's gone and got herself a job in Craddock's garage. I'm not too pleased about it myself. I don't think Bob will want his sister working in the same place.
I can't see why anyone should mind having Gwen around. I just thought he'd be jolly pleased.
We shall see. I dare say the shock's over by now. Well, Dick, I must get on. Got a lot to do. Oh, we had rather a sad thing happen on Friday. Miss Eva Simmons died.
Miss Eva? I'm sorry to hear that. Her sister would be very distressed. I'm very sorry about it, Dr. Dale.
Yes, it's a bad business. She had to go, of course. And she was never really well. But it was a shock when it happened. Well, Dick, we shall see you tonight, I expect.
You will, sir. Bob and I will be arriving with the luggage round about 6:30. I'll see you then, sir. Goodbye, sir.
Hi, Wilkes.
Morning.
Here I am, safe and sound.
Well, well, Mr. Bob. Here you are, back from your holiday. You look nice and brown, Mr. Bob.
I bet I do. We've done nothing but bathe, swim and sail, in the air all the time. It was wonderful, Wilkes. I feel on top of the world. And a glutton for work.
Well, that's good, Mr. Bob, because we're busy as ever. Busier, I should say. This is a new customer's car I'm washing down now. Lives two streets away. Nice bit of body she has. The car, I mean.
Oh, she has. Well, I must go and find Captain Craddock. I suppose he's around somewhere.
As a matter of fact, Mr. Bob, he's just gone off about the oil from Morton's. Won't be 10 minutes, I expect. But your sister's in the office, sir.
My sister? Are you sure?
Of course, Mr. Bob. Got here 9 sharp, she did this morning. Very punctual she is, always. Half an hour early sometimes, like today.
Half an hour early? What on earth? I don't understand.
Didn't you know she was come to work here, Mr. Bob? Been here a week now, she has. Didn't you know?
No, I didn't know.
Well, I expect she was keeping it as a surprise for you, Mr. Bob.
A surprise? Yes, it certainly is a surprise. I must go and see her. Thanks, Wilkes.
I'll see you later, sir. Golly, looks as if I let the cat out of the bag. Anyway, can't see there's any cause for him to scowl about it. Looked like thunder he did, no mistake.
Mrs. Morgan came for the day today. We decided to start turning out the attics, and what a job that was. Now, Mrs. Morgan, all these old medical papers, just look at them. Bundles of them. We must send them to the salvage people.
Don't suppose they do for the white elephant stall for the Guild Bazaar? I wonder now, would they?
Oh, I don't think anybody would want to read these. They're all full of medical details. It's a magazine for doctors only.
Well, all the same, make good reading, they do, I dare say. There's many likes to read about insides. Very interesting insides are.
Well, I think we'd better throw them away. I'm sure Dr. Dale doesn't want them. We can catch the dustman with them today. Oh, and there's a mess of rubbish here. Just look at this, Mrs. Morgan. It's a case full of birds' eggs, and nearly all broken. Bob used to collect them when he was at school. Oh, this must go to the dustman as well.
Well, I could put them on the white elephant stall, what's not broken. Somebody's going to be glad of these, some kid.
Well, if you think they'll be any use. Now, what's this? Do look, Mrs. Morgan. An old gardening head of mine. Can't think what he's doing up here.
Now, that'll be ever so nice for the stall. Some lady'll give us a couple of bob for it.
Oh, no, Mrs. Morgan, you can't put this on the stall.
Can't I and won't I? My friend Mrs. Bitmead and me is running it together. Mrs. Bitmead'll be ever so pleased with this, ma'am.
Mrs. Dale, can I come in? Mrs. Freeman told me you were upstairs here.
Why, Kathy, how nice to see you. I didn't think you were back from your honeymoon.
Good morning, Mrs. Morgan.
Morning, Miss McIntosh.
Mrs. Morgan.
Oh, dear. Mrs. Ferguson, I should say. Well, I'll be taking these rubbish papers down to the dustman now, because I can hear them coming along the road. Excuse me, please, Miss Ferguson.
Oh, I see Mrs. Morgan hasn't changed.
Oh, don't take any notice of her, Cathy. And now, my dear, how are you? Did you have a lovely time?
Oh, we're dead, Mrs. Dale. And Megan Dougal looks so well and brown. And now we're all going to settle down in our own wee house.
Would you like a cup of tea, Kathy?
Well,
oh, let's have one. Oh. I'll come downstairs. I shall be covered in dust. Come along, and we'll have a nice gossip for a quarter of an hour. Kathy stayed for quite a long time. She seems very happy and looked really pretty. I'm going to tea with her on Wednesday. I wanted to run along and see poor Miss Simmons this morning, but I decided to go and do a bit more to the attic first. Mrs. Morgan was downstairs when I heard Jim come in. When I heard him running upstairs.
Mary!
Yes, I'm up here. I'm doing the attic.
You're in the attic. So I've heard. Well, really, Mary, this is too much. If I hadn't happened to meet the dustman...
Meet the dustman? Whatever do you mean?
I've got them all back, the whole lot. But only by sheer luck. You must be off your head.
Off the head? Jim, what are you talking about?
I was driving up Shelley Road and I saw the dustman's van. Just as I got out, a bundle of papers fell off. Then I saw what it was. My magazines. And when I asked them, they had the whole lot. 10 bundles. It's just too much, Mary. I'm really very angry.
Angry? But, Jim, they've been up here for years. All tied up and all covered with dust. You never looked at them once.
I know that, but I might want to. You've no right to try and get rid of my private papers just because you've got a mania for clearing out for the move.
Private papers? A lot of dry as dust magazines.
You wouldn't have chucked them out if they'd been yours, I know.
Well, I'm very sorry, Jim. I'm glad you got them back, that's all. But do remember, at Parkwood Hill, we shan't have any attic.
I shall keep them in a cupboard in my room. I can refer to them then when I want to.
But you never refer to them. You haven't referred to them for years.
I know that, don't I? But don't you see I might want to refer to them? Good heavens, what's all this? It's eggshell.
Bits from Bob's old bird's eggs. They were all broken. There were about 3 whole ones, and Mrs. Morgan's got those for the jumble sale.
Bob's bird's eggs? You haven't thrown away Bob's case of bird's eggs. Well, really, Mary. He'll be absolutely furious with you. This really is the limit.
But he hasn't looked at them for years, and he doesn't collect bird's eggs now.
But he might want to. You've no right to throw away things without asking us.
Oh, I've never heard such rubbish in all my life. A lot of silly old magazines and a case of cracked bird's eggs.
Mummy.
Gwen, what on earth?
Gwen, what are you doing here at this time of the day?
Are you
ill? Did Captain Craddock send you home?
Yes. I mean, no, I finished at Captain Craddock's.
Finished? What on earth are you talking about?
Gwen, what's happened? Is Bob back? Have you seen Bob?
Seen Bob? Of course I've seen Bob. Bob. I never want to see Bob or speak to him again. Never. Never, never, never.
And before we had time to ask any more questions, Gwen turned round and rushed out of the room, slamming the door. She went and locked herself up in her bedroom. Jim was furious, but after a bit he had to go out, and I was left to cope with Gwen on my own. There really are times when I find my family too much for me. And now what's happened? Why on earth should Gwen have left Peter Craddock's? I suppose it's all to do with Bob. So I'd better go and ring up the garage.